You watching this video, you consume on average a credit card's worth of plastic every week. We all do, because plastic is everywhere. It's in our food, our water, it's in the air that we breathe, it's in the topsoil, it's in our pets, it's in our blood. The idea that plastic can be meaningfully recycled is a lie. The industry has known it's a lie for 50 years. 16 tons, and what do you get? Another day older and deeper in debt. Plastic, plastic everywhere. It's used in almost every sector of the economy, with some industries utterly reliant on it. We're currently producing 450 million tons of plastic per year, and about half of that is for single-use products like plastic bags, packaging, food wrappers, and bottles. If there is one statistic that you take away from this video, I ask that it be this. Almost 1 million plastic bottles are produced every minute. That's 1.3 billion every day, about half a trillion every year. Which means that we produce about 60 plastic bottles for every person in the world every year. And plastic production is expected to triple in the next 25 years. I mean, should industrial output not actually collapse, as is predicted by Yale. But that's another video. So, what happens to all that plastic? Worldwide, 71% is dumped in landfills, oceans, or waterways, making its way back into our bodies in the form of microplastics. Another 19% of all plastic is incinerated, and only 9% worldwide is recycled. In the United States, it's about 4%. Up to 90% of plastic cannot be recycled, for both economic and technical reasons. But the plastics industry has spent decades convincing people that recycling is the answer to plastic waste, to ensure that we keep consuming more and more and more. Plastic is a loose term to describe malleable materials that can be shaped and molded using heat and pressure. There was a lot of experimentation in the 19th century, but the first fully synthetic plastic was invented in 1907 by a Belgian chemist named Leo Baekeland, who called his invention Bakelite, made by combining formaldehyde and phenol under heat and pressure. It was cheap and easy to make, and was used to make things like telephones, radios, kitchenware, and children's toys.
Resinoid plastics grew up and were made useful in these extensive research laboratories of the Bakelite Corporation. And here too, they are multiplied and adapted to the future needs of every industry on Earth.
In the early decades of the 20th century, the petroleum and chemical industries began working together in companies like Dow Chemicals, DuPont, and Exxon for the purpose of trying to make use of the waste materials of oil and gas processing. And that's what they did. 99% of today's plastic is made from chemicals sourced from fossil fuels. Many popular modern plastics that we use now were created in the 1920s and 30s, such as polythene, nylon, and Teflon. They were seen as miracle materials, cheap, light, and durable. Plastics in household products became popular in the 1950s. At first, the industry marketed them as sturdy and reusable. This ad from DuPont in 1955 shows just that.
Whoops, that could have been a mess. An unbreakable plastic container seems to be a must with kids around the house.
But that messaging quickly began to change in 1956 at the plastic industry's annual conference in New York. There, the editor of a trade magazine for the plastic industry, Lloyd Stouffer, urged the industry to stop marketing plastic for its durability because they could make a lot more money by selling plastic as cheap and disposable. That was no easy task in the 1950s, when people had lived through the Great Depression and World War II and were inclined to save and reuse as much as possible, or at least more than they are now. So the industry worked hard to make people see plastic as cheap, abundant, and desirable. In 1960, the Scott Paper Company commissioned a marketing study and determined that, among other things, disposable plastic cups should be marketed as child-friendly to the lower class, a status symbol to the middle class, and a convenience to the upper class. At the 1963 National Plastics Conference, Stufer returned and congratulated the industry for its success in getting people to see plastic as cheap and abundant, saying, "The happy day has arrived, when nobody any longer considers the package too good to throw away." By the 1970s, the industry was booming, especially after 1973, when PET bottles were patented, allowing the beverage industry to begin selling soft drinks in plastic bottles. But a new problem was also emerging. People were fine with seeing plastic as disposable, but plastic litter in the environment was becoming more noticeable, and the industry feared profits would decline, whether by government regulation or consumers turning away from plastic. So the plastics industry and the beverage industry teamed up to introduce a solution that wouldn't involve people buying less: plastic recycling. And there's loads of evidence from internal industry documents from the 1970s to the 1990s showing that the industry fully knew that plastic recycling is neither technically nor economically viable at any meaningful scale. Former industry officials have said outright that the goal of pushing recycling was to avoid regulations and ensure that demand for plastic continued to grow. And grow it has. From the 1970s to the 90s, plastic production tripled. In the early 2000s, the amount of plastic waste produced increased more in a single decade than it had in the previous 40 years. So, why are the majority of plastics not recyclable? First, the economic limitations. Virgin plastic, the stuff freshly made from oil and gas, is simply cheaper than recycled plastic. Why? Because oil and gas is government subsidized in almost every nation on Earth. It's estimated that worldwide, governments spend up to about $1 trillion a year subsidizing the fossil fuel industry. Recycled plastic just cannot compete with new plastic in terms of price. But there are also technical barriers. There are 7 types of plastic, based on the type of resin used to produce it. You can see these numbers on most packaging. However, there are actually thousands of different plastics made with various additives to give them particular properties like strength, heat resistance, flexibility, color, and so on. That variation prevents most of these plastics from being recycled together. When you grind them up and melt them, they create a mush that is completely unusable, or, if you're very lucky, a nice little piece of coal. In addition, many plastic products contain other materials that cannot be separated from the plastic itself. For example, many single-use plastics also contain paper, metal, or adhesive components that are difficult or impossible to separate from the plastic. Even products made from the same type of plastic often cannot be recycled together. Green PET bottles can't be recycled with clear PET bottles. Flexible, single-use plastics make up about 40% of all plastic packaging. Think plastic wrap, candy wrappers, chip bags, sandwich bags, whatever. These are often super contaminated with food waste, making them impossible to recycle. In fact, mixed-use recycling bins, putting all different recyclables into the same bin, can contaminate all of the plastic inside and make it unrecyclable. There are plenty of other contaminants that have the same effect. Plastic containers of pesticides and cleaning solvents can contaminate entire bins. And of course, some of the harder varieties of plastics are specifically designed to be nearly heatproof, making them impossible to melt down and repurpose. Others contain toxic chemicals like stabilizers, catalysts, coatings, and flame retardants. Not recyclable. And finally, the quality of plastic degrades as it is recycled. The plastics industry has spent decades telling us what we need is a circular economy, their words, where plastic is recycled and used over and over, ad infinitum, like water. But the reality is that most plastic can be recycled only once, maybe twice, but it's just a brief pit stop on its way to a landfill or incinerator. They know this. When they deny it, they are lying. The bottom line is, if you put plastic waste labelled number 1 or number 2 in a recycling bin, it might get recycled one time. If you put in plastic numbers 3 to 7, they are almost always dumped in landfills or incinerated. And the consequences of all this plastic waste are dire. For the environment, yes, tiny particles of plastic have been found everywhere on Earth, from the top of Mount Everest to the bottom of the Mariana Trench. But they're also in our bodies. We have microplastics in our lungs, our livers, our kidneys, our spleens, our brains, our blood. Microplastics have been found in breast milk, in testicles, in the placentas of newborn babies. Even our dogs have microplastics in their testicles. And yes, dumping plastic in landfills and waterways is a big part of this, contaminating our groundwater and soil with microplastics. But it's worse than that. Multiple studies have shown that up to 90% of food in the grocery store contains microplastics already. Fruits, vegetables, meat, fish, meat substitutes, and processed foods. Not just in America, throughout the entire industrialized world. And that plastic contamination isn't just from the packaging. Agricultural soil is contaminated with microplastics from using wastewater and sewage sludge on crops, and plastic mulch used to retain water. The plastics are absorbed by the roots of plants we eat, and that our livestock eat. Even the air in your home contains microplastics from the synthetic fibers in your clothes, carpet, curtains, and upholstery. Use a washing machine or a dishwasher, microplastics are released into the wastewater and end up in the environment. And while the dangers of microplastics in the human body are not fully understood, we do know that microplastic in people is linked to low sperm count, fertility issues, linked to obesity, metabolic disorders, thyroid problems, autoimmune diseases, and cancer. Plastic is indispensable for certain applications, such as medical equipment, for which we can't easily, at least right now, substitute other materials. The majority of plastic produced isn't for medical equipment, or to help people in a meaningful way. It's crap. It's cheap stuff that is so cheap that it doesn't even matter if you throw it away. And of course, it's not finite. It will run out. There are a million hopes and prayers out there pinned on human ingenuity or other such mythical beasts to save us from this and so much more. But the truth is, the plastic on beaches, in blood, in children, right now, is as good as it gets, eating the equivalent of this drone in plastic every year. At least for a few thousand years, fingers crossed. Now when I think of the apocalypse, I don't have Peter O'Toole's voice going, "Look what man has wrought," with the image of an A-bomb going off, but rather an enormous margarine tub emerging, sort of like the opposite of Terminator 2. And it's full of smaller margarine tubs, but not like Russian dolls. It's all like, they're all misshapen and don't stack well. It's awful. What a terrible future. And that's what we'll be eating. Anyway, thanks very much for watching. Don't let it get you down. Not because it isn't serious or anything. It is, just... you know, subscribe, keep your chin up and everything. Don't forget to laminate your subscription. Check me out, my, you know, and all that. And thyroid storm approaching, smoke your reds. All right, see ya. Bye-bye. That's it. That's it.